To welcome you to the annual public lecture of the Anton Mostert Chair in Intellectual Property Law. Now, a public lecture is important for a number of reasons. And the first one is, I think the important reason is that we have the opportunity to showcase what I shall call the academic footprint of the particular entity. An academic footprint, of course, is the management talk for academic activities. But we can showcase the academic footprint of tonight, the Chair in Intellectual Property Law. And I think it's very important to have an opportunity like this because we can tell you how proud we are of the achievements of this particular Chair, and I'm going to elaborate on that in a few moments. Public lecture is also very important because of the content of the address, and tonight we have very high expectations because our guest speaker is none other than Professor Owen Dean, and I'm going to introduce him also in a few minutes. And the third reason why the public lecture is very important is because we have the opportunity afterwards, of course, to mingle, to discuss the address, the lecture, to share ideas, ask questions, and of course to strengthen relationships, to establish partnerships, and just to have a splendid evening. So to go back to the first reason, it's an opportunity to tell you about the activities of the Chair. The Chair was established in 2011, and it has since introduced a Master's in Intellectual Property Law. We have a sort of an average stream of 25 students who graduate from this program. A postgraduate diploma in Intellectual Property Law was introduced. The only IP program in South Africa that admits non-law students to study IP law. And under the guidance of Professor Owen Dean, the Chair also offers a certificate short course in cooperation with UCT, hereby extending the faculty's offering to non-legal part-time students. The past 3 years, the Chair of IP Law has been instrumental in the drafting of and will lead the debate on the following: the draft national policy on intellectual property, the promotion and protection of investment law, the protection, promotion and management of indigenous knowledge systems law, the new heraldry act, the intellectual property laws amendment law, the Protection of Traditional Knowledge Law, and the Copyright Amendment Law. Closer to home, the Chair of the IP Law serves the university community by advising and assisting, amongst others, the Division of Legal Services, ILUFIS, the Division of Short Courses, the Media Lab at the Faculty of Engineering, the Centre for Teaching and Learning, the Library Services Division, as well as researchers and students for almost every faculty. Professor Dean's reputation and expertise continues to draw wide attention, which he reinvests into the university and the faculty. For example, under his editorial control, the members of the Chair of IP Law and practitioners from Spur & Fisher published the first comprehensive book handling on all fields of IP law in 2014. And a year later, in 2015, this book is considered as the primary source of research material in IP law, and it is used as the prescribed textbook at all South African universities who offer IP law at postgraduate level. Owen, of course, has himself published a total of 2 books and contributed chapters to several others in the past 4 years, and in addition to his already long list of publications, of course. So the IP Stellenbosch online journal, established by Owen, has published no less than 72 articles in the past 4 years, and is frequently cited with authority for its broadly direct and academically pure approach to law review. Going back to the Chair, the Anton Mostert Chair of Intellectual Property Law has the stated goals of protecting and promoting intellectual property law and practice through high-level engagement, research, and teaching in all fields of the law that make up the various disciplines in IP law. So it is therefore not surprising that since its establishment, the IP Public Lecture has presented the work of leaders in the field, amongst others, design, patents and mobile technology, trademark infringement in the digital environment, online commerce and counterfeit goods. Tonight, the third pillar of IP law, namely copyright law, will be discussed. I think it's thus appropriate that the lecture should be presented by South Africa's foremost authority on copyright law, Professor Owen Dean. So it is now my pleasure to introduce the speaker for tonight. Owen has held the Chair of Intellectual Property since its establishment plans to retire at the end of the year, so tonight is also an occasion where we celebrate all his achievements spanning a number of years. His list of achievements is long, and I'm going to mention a few. And I don't think many of you know that Owen started his career in the diplomatic service and spent 4 years at the South African Embassy in The Hague between 1967 and 1972. He returned to South Africa in 1972 and joined the intellectual property law firm of Swirl & Fisher in Pretoria, where he soon distinguished himself by bringing several cases that made new law. Now, there are a number, but I want to mention one. First one, and to date, the only case brought on the basis of a well-known foreign trademark in the McDonald's Corporation versus Joburg's driving restaurant case. Of course, Owen's most famous case is the matter of Disney Enterprises versus Griesel, better known as Lion Sleeps Tonight and Booby case, where Owen successfully represented the heirs of Solomon Linda in a copyright infringement suit against Walt Disney Enterprises for the use of the song Booby, more than 50 years after Disney's death. This case spanned several years and repeatedly made headline news around the world, particularly after Owen successfully attached all of Walt Disney's registered trademarks in South Africa to vest jurisdiction of the court. Owen's commitment to legal development also extends beyond the courtroom. His reputation as Mr. Copyright in practice is reflected in his publication history. As I mentioned, it includes 4 books, a number of articles in local, foreign, and international journals, and he quite literally wrote the book on copyright law in South Africa with the Handbook of South African Copyright Law, first published in 1987, and currently in its 14th revision and 3rd edition. Owen serves as a member in a number of international editorial boards. He wrote several statutes, I'm only going to mention one, the Protection of Traditional Knowledge Bill of 2013, which is currently before Parliament. Owen, of course, is a frequent speaker on intellectual property matters at seminars and conferences on a national level, international meetings. He was also appointed to the panel of adjudicators for South African domain name disputes, the World Intellectual Property Organization panel of arbitrators for domain name disputes, the Stellenbosch University Business School panel of mediators, and the Intellectual Property panel of the Arbitration Federation of South Africa. Owen is listed as a senior statesman of intellectual property and a key individual of Spur and Fisher by Chambers and Partners in 2012 and 2013 in the global, wide, and pan-regional sections of the Chambers Global Ranking. Has also been selected by his peers for inclusion in the best lawyers of South Africa in the practice area of intellectual property law in 2014-2015. And he also served as chairman of Spur & Fisher for several years. In 2010, he retired after 38 years in practice and returned to his roots in Western Cape. In his own words, living in exile in Pretoria for 55 years. He remains a consultant to Spur and Fisher. Other than Jean de Villiers and Victor Matfield, Owen made a comeback injury-free when he, in 2011, became the first incumbent of the Anton Mostert Chair of Intellectual Property Law endowed by the Richmond Group and housed by the Faculty of Law. Owen is also an ordinary human being. He's happily married to Donna. It's lovely to have you here tonight. They are the proud parents of 3 children and 3 grandchildren. May I say, Owen is also a very loyal colleague, a true gentleman, and ladies and gentlemen, it gives me great pleasure to hand over the microphone to Owen.
Thank you, Sonia. After an introduction like that, I'm almost inclined to say let's go and drink, because your attention has been kept long enough. When Mark Antony spoke at Julius Caesar's funeral in Shakespeare's play, he said near the beginning of his speech, "I come to bury Caesar, not to praise him." Well, I'm going to adopt a different approach. I come not to bury copyright, but to praise it. And I praise it because I think that it fulfills a very useful function in our socioeconomic environment. I think it can benefit the population as a whole in South Africa, particularly those who are haven't been fortunate to have proper schooling and that sort of thing, and I'll explain to you why during the course of this address. I hope to persuade you by the end of this talk that copyright is indeed an agent for social justice. Now, copyright is part of the family of law known as intellectual property. Intellectual property protects the intangible results of creative activity, the fruits of the mind, so to speak. It consists basically of four areas of law: patents, trademarks, copyright, and designs. Now, there's an underlying principle as to why the law protects intellectual property, and that is that it is intended as an incentive to inspire and to encourage creative people to use their creative talents and their expertise to create works and inventions and so forth for the common good. What intellectual property does is to provide an incentive to the creative person. And this is achieved by the state entering into a sort of a compact with the creative individual, in terms of which the individual is given a monopoly for a limited period to use the work or the idea, invention, whatever, which has been created to his own advantage, on condition that at the end of a prescribed term, that work is donated to the public, as it were, it forms part of the public domain. So in this way, the individual is encouraged to get out and to create, and he has an opportunity to get his pound of flesh out of what he has created. So there is that very strong incentive. Now, IP, intellectual property, essentially creates a form of monopolies. Now, in this current day and age, monopolies are not always viewed benignly. In fact, if anything, monopoly becomes a bit of a swear word. And so IP has in recent times been subjected to quite a bit of criticism. It is seen by some as a means of exploiting for the haves to exploit the have-nots, for the rich countries to exploit the developing countries. Particularly in fields like pharmaceuticals, medicines, there is a strong movement to have drugs, for instance, antiretroviral drugs, freely available at no or little cost, whereas what the patent system envisages is that the inventor of these drugs should have an opportunity to get his pound of flesh out of his invention. So in this day and age, there is quite a strong movement to sort of curtail intellectual property rights and to water them down, which I think is a negative development. Copyright, however, is in a sense in a class of its own, because it doesn't have many of the what is seen to be bad attributes of intellectual property. For instance, it is said that patenting is all well and good, but to register a patent in South Africa, let alone internationally, costs an absolute fortune, and consequently very few people can afford to do that. And that may be just or may be fair criticism, but copyright, by contrast, comes for nothing. You don't have to pay anything to get copyright. So it is not subject to some of the let's call it disadvantages which exist in the case of other forms of intellectual property. Now, this is my definition of copyright. Copyright is the exclusive right in relation to a work embodying intellectual property, that is the product of the intellect, to do or to authorize others to do certain acts in relation to that work, which acts represent, in the case of each type of work, the manners in which that work can be exploited for personal gain or profit. So, in other words, if you write a work, in terms of the law of copyright, you are given a limited monopoly to exploit that work, and the way in which your monopoly operates is to give you the exclusive right to perform the kind of activities in relation to that work which are of a nature that enable money to be made from the use of that web. It enables them to be exploited for commercial advantage. Now, I've listed here some characteristics of copyright, and in a sense, by contrast to the other forms of intellectual property. Copyright exists automatically, provided certain conditions are met. There is no system of registration. If you want to, for instance, get rights to the invention, you have to go and register a patent. That costs you a lot of money. Copyright exists automatically. The moment you put pen to paper and you produce a written work, copyright exists automatically. As I said, provides certain conditions are met. Now, the first of those conditions is that the work must be original. Now, that doesn't mean that it has to be unique or inventive in any way. It simply means that it must be your own work, your own product of your own creativity. And conversely, it means it must not be copied from something else. The second and basic requirement for the existence of copyright is that the work must exist in a material form. So you don't have copyright in ideas. You might have an idea for an amazing plot for a novel or an amazing tune for a song. If you don't write it down or record it in a material form, there is no work and you can have no copyright. So provided those two very simple conditions are met, namely the work exists, it is original, it is your own work, it is not copied from something else, and it exists in a material form, you have copyright, whether you like it or not. The law gives it to you free, gratis, and for nothing. And what's more, the law gives you that right to that work, not only in South Africa, but essentially throughout the world. There is a system of international conventions, more particularly the Berne Convention and the TRIPS Agreement, part of the GATT Agreement on trade and tariffs, in terms of which countries, all member countries of these conventions, which essentially amount to all the countries in the world, grant each other reciprocal protection. So when you write your little piece of whatever, a letter for that matter, your copyright exists automatically, and it exists automatically throughout the world. Every other country which is a member of these conventions will grant you the same protection and recognition as it will grant to works made in that country itself. So you can imagine, by a very simple act, you can acquire this tremendously valuable piece of property. It has tremendous potential. And the copyright, once it comes into existence, is owned by the maker of the work, the author, in general terms. There are exceptions, but in general terms, the person who makes the work is the owner of the copyright. The term of copyright is very long. In general terms, exists for the lifetime of the author or maker of the work, plus 50 years beyond his death. I sum up, you get this right for nothing. It must meet very few conditions. It is valid worldwide. You own it without having to do anything to acquire ownership other than create the work. And it exists for your own lifetime, plus 50 years after your death. What an amazing gift that you were given, really, by the state for doing very little. It can be assigned and it can be licensed, and that's really how one commercializes it to a large extent. You, for instance, one writes a book, you go to a publisher, you assign the copyright to the publisher, he publishes the book, and that's how you earn income out of the book. Or alternatively, you grant licenses, and you get royalties for sales of the book. So those are the ways in which you commercially exploit the work. Now, there is a whole range of classes of works which are eligible for copyright. There's in fact 9 of them. I'm not going to deal with all of them. The ones which are important for our purposes for tonight are literary works, artistic works, and musical works. Don't be misled by the literal meaning of these terms. A literary work to enjoy protection doesn't have to be a work of Shakespeare or of that sort of ilk. Anything which is written down, a more appropriate term would really be a written work. So the most mundane pieces of writing, slogans for advertisements, for instance, have been held to be literary works. paragraphs in a book, even sentences, mere sentences can be literary works, irrespective of their literary quality or the content of what they contain. Likewise, with artistic works, you don't have to be a Rembrandt to make an artistic work. An artistic work in copyright terms is really a graphic work. It's something expressed pictorially. And artistic quality is of absolutely no consequence whatsoever. Same with musical works. Musical works are melodies, whether they are good, bad, or indifferent melodies, whether they are works of Bach or Beethoven or some simple jingle which is used in an advertisement, they are all musical works and they all are entitled to copyright protection. So it's a very all-embracing system. Now, what does your copyright give you? It gives you various, it gives you exclusive rights to perform various activities. And the most important ones for our present purposes are reproduction, making copies of the work. And I say copies because for a reproduction to make inroads on copyright, there must be actual copying. So if I make a work and someone makes a similar work, but had no reference to my work, the two can live side by side. Copyright infringement only comes into question if there has been actual copying. Publication, that's pretty straightforward. Adaptation is somewhat similar to reproduction, but it entails things like translations, where it goes further than or wider than a reproduction. Public performance on stage, musical work, singing songs at a function, whatever. Broadcasting, that's straightforward. That's television and sound. Now, your copyright covers these activities not only in relation to the whole work, but also in relation to what the law terms any substantial part. So if someone copies my page out of my book, he doesn't get off the book for copyright infringement by making changes here and there and perhaps paraphrasing what I've said. What the court will look at is whether any substantial part of the book has been reproduced. Now, these are important issues. Coming back to reproduction, as I mentioned, there must be copying. But you can copy not only by making a direct copy, but also by making an indirect copy. For instance, if I have a painting and someone takes a photograph of my painting and a third person comes along and makes another painting based on the photograph, he's indirectly copying my painting. He might never have seen my painting, he's only seen the intermediate reproduction, namely the photograph. But by copying something which is itself a copy of my painting, he is indirectly copying my painting. And this has relevance to this Lion Sleeps Tonight text. So what are these social attributes of copyright? Firstly, in my view, and perhaps most importantly, automatic acquisition. No registration, no cost involved. You don't have to go and pay lawyers to go and file an application anywhere. What is created is a right of property. The Constitution recognizes intellectual property and copyright as a form of property of equal stature to land or movable goods like motor cars, etc. No cost is incurred in creating this property. You get it for nothing, whether you like it or not. You might not even want it, but you get it whether you want it or not. It costs you nothing. It exists and can be enforced worldwide, and that's a very important element, as we will see from this Lion Sleeps Tonight case. It's readily enforceable by the court. The infringement of your copyright creates an entitlement to go to court and to ask the court to restrain the infringing conduct, and also, if damages have been suffered, to pay damages by way of compensation. It can be transmitted, as I mentioned, by assignments or licenses, and that is how an income flow is achieved. And the value of this property, which is given to you for nothing, depends entirely on the merits of the product itself. You don't have to have a degree in fine arts to paint a successful picture which can be commercially exploited and earn you lots of money. The success and the ability of your work to generate income depends entirely on its merits. It's got nothing to do with the qualifications or the education or whatever of the person who created the work. And we'll see how this played itself out in this Lion Sleeps Tonight case. So these are, in my view, very substantial social attributes and which make copyright something which is available to the most simple, most uneducated, most common person in our society. Everybody can sit down and paint a picture. Some are better than others, but the point is the potential is there at no cost and at no formalities to obtain an item of property which you can use in order to generate income. Now this brings me to the Lion Sleeps Tonight case, and I'm using this case as an example, as a case study of how copyright actually in a particular situation brought about social justice. Now, I'll be the first person to admit that this is an unusual case and it has many complications and intricacies which probably won't apply easily in other cases, but the basic principle nevertheless remains. It is exemplary of what copyright can do in order to benefit unschooled, uneducated people. Now the saga involving this case began in May 2000 with an article which appeared in a magazine called Rolling Stone, which is kind of the Bible of the international entertainment business and more particularly the music business. If you look at the bottom right-hand side of the cover of the magazine, which is what is on the screen before you, it says, "Money, Greed, and Mystery. Who wrote The Lion Sleeps Tonight?" So this, an article appeared in this edition of Rolling Stone. Now this article was written by Rion Lun, who is an investigative journalist. He was, I think he was a grandson or a nephew or something of D.F. Lun, but despite that he was something of a black sheep of the family, and he went into exile in America during the apartheid years. And he used the opportunity to hone his skills as an investigative journalist. Now he came back to South Africa and he came across this story which he wrote up in Rolling Stone. And it was a story about a very simple, uneducated man who wrote a song. That song made its way to America, became very famous. It was adapted by a very famous American folk singer of the time, Pete Seeger. It then was adapted a further time, and eventually it ended up in the stage show and the movie The Lion King. And over the years, it made millions, if not billions, of US dollars. It was one of the most successful pop songs ever written and ever commercially released. But regrettably, none of those bounties came the way of the family of the composer, Solomon Linda, or after he died, his family, and they lived in abject poverty. And Rion Lun thought that this was a very unhappy, intolerable situation. And he wrote this article in which he described this whole process. Now, it began with a song composed by Solomon Linda, who was a Zulu man from Zululand, because I suppose that speaks for itself to some extent. He was a herdsman looking after cattle in Zululand. He came to the big bright city of Johannesburg in the 1930s, 1940s. He got a job as a floor, as a sweeper, a cleaner of the Gallo Records warehouse in Johannesburg. He was that menial in his upbringing and so forth. But he also moonlighted as a singer, a performing artist, singing some of his own songs with a group called the Evening Birds, and they performed at Shabeen's in Sophia Town and so forth in Johannesburg at the time when Sophia Town was at its height. Gallo, his employer, decided to make a record of his song, which was called Mbubi, which means lion in Zulu, so I'm told. This song was released by Gallo, and it became quite successful within its sort of environment. I mean, it was obviously very ethnic, which you'll hear in a moment. But nevertheless, it enjoyed a measure of success, mainly amongst black people in the Johannesburg area. And this is what the song sounded like. Just pause for a moment. When you, as the song is ending, you will hear the leading voice, which is Solomon Linda, sort of go up quite a scale and just kind of hum a particular melody. Just pay attention to that melody. So, this song was released in South Africa, enjoyed a mild measure of success. Gallo were the South African representatives of the well-known international record company, Decca. And at a given time, Decca asked Gallo to send them new material as far as the American market was concerned. They wanted to see whether there was anything they considered to be worthwhile coming out of South Africa, which they could release internationally. So Gallo got together a whole lot of recordings, including Mbubi, and sent them over to the United States. Decca listened to these recordings and didn't really think any of them had any potential at all, and they sort of almost washed their hands of it. But one of their contracted artists was Pete Seeger, who was, as I mentioned earlier, a very famous, at the time, first to become pop singer in the United States. And they said to him, look, here's some stuff from South Africa, listen to it and see whether you find anything there which interests you. And if you do, well, you know, we can look at sort of making a recording or taking it further. So he listened to this stuff, and he came across Mbube, which he thought had potential. But now all he had to go on for that song was the recording, which you heard. He didn't have sheet music or anything like that. So what he did was he, working from the record, he transcribed the song and he decided to adapt it and release it as his own song, which he did. And that gave rise to this song.
Thank you.
famous. I mean, it was released by Pete Seeger, but it was also released by a whole lot of other artists at the time. We're talking kind of late 1950s, early 1960s. And it reached the hit parades, and it really was a pretty successful song. But then what happened was that a gentleman by the name of George Weiss, who wrote a lot of music for Elvis Presley, and he wrote numerous popular songs. He wrote A Wonderful World, which was sung by Louis Armstrong. And he got hold of this song, and he made yet a further adaptation of it. And he added some words to it, and he called it The Lion Sleeps Tonight. And this was the song as adapted by him. He worked from Wimmerway. He'd never come across Mbube, but he worked from Wimmerway, so he was indirectly copying Mbube. This recording was made by a group called the Tokens. Thank you. Okay, so what you have seen there was a progression starting with Ngume, a very primitive tribal type song. It underwent first a metamorphosis into Wimowe and then into The Lion Sleeps Tonight. And along the way, it picked up fame and popularity and it earned an enormous amount of money. I mean, it's mind-boggling telephone numbers that this song earned over that period. But as I said, and as Leon Milan mentioned in his article, none of this money found its way back to the family. Solomon Linda died in 1962 as a pauper. He left a wife and three daughters who lived in Soweto. They lived in poverty, they had virtually no education, so they were really in dire straits, but yet their father and husband's song had made all of these millions of dollars. And it was Rion Milan thought that this was extremely unjust. He wrote this article, and it caused quite a stir in South Africa. We're now talking about 2000, the new South Africa had not been going for very long. And it was said to be a case of exploitation of poor black people by white big money, and it really took on quite a strong political connotation. Gallo at that time had become part of a group called the Jonic Group, and the chairman of the Jonic Group was actually Cyril Ramaphosa. And the Rion Milan's article really cast Gallo in quite a bad light, because Gallo was the company which had sent this song over to America and started it down its road to fame without looking after, so the article said, in any way looking after the interests of Solomon Linda and his family. So Gallo were not looking good in the public eye. So on a good day, Gallo, who were clients of mine, contacted me and said, look, we want to come and see you and discuss a matter with you. I said, fine. And they arrived with a suitcase full of documents, hard about this high. And they said, look, this is the background to this whole situation. We want to try and do something about it. We want to try and somehow bring about a situation where the family can benefit, at least to some extent, from these millions of dollars washing around. Can you please go through all this stuff and see whether you can find some basis on which we can make a claim, or we can pursue some sort of an argument that the family should get some slice of the action. So I went through all of these documents, and the picture they painted was not at all good, because in 1952, Solomon Linda entered into an assignment of copyright with Gallo at the time when the record of Mbube was made, in which he assigned all his right, title, and interest to the song to Gallo for the princely sum of 10 shillings, which in those days was the equivalent of a rand. Now, when you assign copyright, you divest yourself entirely of your rights. It's like selling your house. Once you've sold your house, it's gone. It belongs to the new owner, and you have no claim to that house at all. So Solomon Linda, probably inadvisedly, or not having not been advised at all, assigned his copyright to Gallo in 1952. And Gallo, in turn, assigned it on to the American interest. So it was gone. It was out of the hands of Solomon Linda for his family. And then, to make matters worse, this is the assignment. To make matters worse, in 1980, the American company who had acquired the copyright from Gallo decided on a belt and braces approach to contact Solomon Linda's widow, Regina, as well as his three daughters, and get them to execute yet another assignment of copyright in their favor, against the possibility that something had fallen between the cracks, and that it could possibly be argued that they didn't own the full copyright. So there were two assignments of copyright. Firstly by Solomon Linder, and secondly by his widow and children, divesting themselves entirely of any rights to this song. So it didn't create a really encouraging picture. I mean, there were a mountain of license agreements and all sorts of things, but they were of no assistance at all to the Linder family. And I felt quite bad about it, because to me it seemed a just cause, and I really thought it would be nice to come up with some sort of slick argument which would entitle the family to get some claim to these monies. And then I had a eureka moment. I remembered something I'd come across some 12 years previously while writing my doctoral thesis. And that was a very strange provision in an earlier Copyright Act which I had studied, because my thesis dealt with the way in which the current Copyright Act deals with works made in the past, in other words, when previous Copyright Acts were in progress. And it was a strange quirk of copyright law is that every time you get a new Copyright Act, the new Copyright Act says, we will preserve rights which came into existence under the preceding Act. So the current Act says that in the case of works made during the term of a preceding Act, the existence, ownership, and the duration of the copyright is determined by the law which was in place at the time when the work was made. Now, Solomon Linder wrote that song in around about 1950. At that time, we had a 1916 Copyright Act. Now, our 1916 Copyright Act was quite unusual because, in fact, it was an act which dealt with all branches of intellectual property. So it had a part dealing with patents, a part dealing with trademarks, a part dealing with designs, and a part dealing with copyright. But when it came to the part dealing with copyright, what it said was, in the third schedule, which you see there, we incorporate homus bonus, the British Copyright Act of 1911. So in other words, what our legislature said in 1916, we're not going to reinvent the wheel. We're just going to take the British Copyright Act of 1911 and put it as an annexure to our act and say that is our law of copyright. So that was what was done in the 1916 Act. Now that wasn't done purely out of laziness, because we were at that time a part of the British Empire. And the British Empire, the British decided that their Copyright Act of 1911 should apply throughout the Empire. So every country in the British Empire had to enact this Copyright Act. It was called the Imperial Copyright Act for good reason. So we took the Imperial Copyright Act and we just made it our law and said that's our law of copyright. Now this act had a really strange provision in it. And it said that if during his lifetime the maker or the author of a work assigns his copyright to a third person, 25 years after his death, in other words, for the remaining 25 years, bearing in mind the copyright term is lifetime plus 50 years, so for the last 25 years of the copyright, the ownership of the copyright reverted to the author's heirs. So this meant that this case the Solomon Linder fact fell four squarely into this strange provision. So, in terms of this provision, the ownership of Ngubi in 1987, 25 years after Solomon Linder's death, reverted to his heirs. But the interesting thing was that it did so not only in South Africa, but throughout the British Empire, because this law applied throughout the British Empire. So every country in the British Empire had the same provision. So I went back to Ghana and I said to them, I wrote an opinion, and I said to them, actually I found that there is something you can do because of this very strange and obscure provision of the 1916 Copyright Act coming from the British 1911 Copyright Act. I think most people thought I'd gone mad in coming up with this idea, but nevertheless, I was convinced that it was correct. So I said, in fact, there is something you can actually claim royalties for all use of Wimmerway and the Lion Sleeps Tonight since 1987, because from 1987 onwards, the heirs of Sullivan and Linda became the owner of Mbube, and by extension, having rights in both Wimmerway and Lion Sleeps Tonight throughout the British Empire, the British Commonwealth. And they said, well, that's very interesting. And I thought they would throw a party or something. But the silence was deafening. For 2 years, they did absolutely nothing. In the meantime, this controversy raged on about how the family of Sullivan and Linda were being hard done by not having a share of this money. And Rion Milan had got hold of a lawyer by the name of Hanro Friedrich, and they gave press conferences and all sorts of things saying they were sure that something could be done and they want to get hold of the contracts and they wanted to try and cancel some of these old contracts and things. And I really had to sit on my hands, so to speak, because I knew that they were barking up the wrong tree. And I knew that there was a solution at hand, but I wasn't at liberty to go and tell other people, third parties, what advice I'd given to Ghana. So there was nothing I could do. I had to say it's tight. Anyway, 2 years went by, and then one day I got another phone call from Ghana, and they said they want to come and see me. So I said, fine. They arrived with a whole entourage of people, including Rion Milan, the lawyer Hanro Friedrich, the three daughters of Sullivan and Linda. And they came to me and they said, we have decided we're going to push this matter to the ultimate. We don't mind what it costs. You have complete carte blanche. Do whatever you think is necessary and possible to ensure that some flow of money comes to the family. So I said, well, it's a lawyer's dream to get a discussion like that, particularly a bit about spare no money. Anyway, so we sat down and we thought, well, now, this is really quite an obscure principle of law that we rely on, and if I were, for instance, to write an article, people would laugh at me and say, well, this guy's been smoking something. In order to get credibility for this argument, we had to conduct a test case. That is, sue somebody successfully and thereby prove the point that it wasn't some figment of my imagination that there was this principle applicable. And we thought that the higher the profile of the person we sue, the greater would be the impact of this successful judgment that we would get down the line. And then we thought, well, who better to sue but Walt Disney, because they were one of the chief exponents of The Lion Sleeps Tonight at that stage, and the stage show was actually running in London. So we hatched the scheme that we would sue Walt Disney in London for infringing copyright in Mbube. So we adopted this grand design and we said, right, let's do that. But there was a small technicality that we had to take care of, and that is that this provision of the British 1911 Imperial Copyright Act didn't return the copyright to the heirs. It returned the copyright to the executor of the heirs. In other words, the whole idea was that the executor would obtain ownership on a temporary basis of this copyright, and then he would do with it what he thought best, and presumably that the most cases the idea would be to assign it to the heirs, but it didn't go immediately to the heirs. It had to go via the executor, which actually was fortuitous for us. In fact, it was crucial for us because, bearing in mind the 1980 assignment, that Regina and the three daughters had executed. Now, at the time that that assignment was executed, it wasn't with the paper that was written on because they didn't own the copyright. But as soon as the copyright came home to roost, as it were, in them, that assignment would click in, and it would be a very pyrrhic victory for us to establish that the widow and the daughters owned the copyright, only to have it fly out of the window immediately and go to the assignee. So it suited us to have the copyright go first to an executor. So we decided that the executor would have to bring this litigation. But now we had to find an executor from somewhere. Now, Solomon Lyndon died in 1962. He was a poor black man in the height of apartheid who lived in Soweto. We had no idea whether he had a will or whether he died intestate or what the circumstances were of his death. So we made inquiries and we found that he in fact had died intestate while living in Soweto. So we went to the master of the Supreme Court in Pretoria, having jurisdiction over the then Transvaal, and we said to him, right, we want you to please appoint an executor in Solomon Lyndon's estate. He died in 1962, some 40 years ago, but we've come across this valuable asset which was not known at the time of his death, so we need to reopen his estate so we can do the right thing with this asset. So the master looked at us and said, this is quite a tall order, wanting to open an estate of a black person who died 40 years previous. But he said, but in fact, I'm not the person you need to talk to. You must go and talk to the magistrate in Johannesburg. Because at that time, in 1962, the estates of black people were administered by the magistrate who had jurisdiction over where they lived, in this case, the magistrate of Johannesburg. So we traced off to the magistrate in Johannesburg, and we said to him, please, we want to see your file of 40 years ago when Solomon Linda, who died in this state, black person living in Soweto, you must have opened the file. So the magistrate said, well, you must have come to ask me for files dating back 40 years ago. And more or less sent us back and saying, this is a joke, because I don't have files dating back 40 years ago. But what you might do is go and look in the state archives, because all that sort of stuff we just packed up and sent to the state archives. So we then traced off to the state archives. And lo and behold, after some small amount of searching, we actually did find the file. Solomon Lyndon's estate's file dating from 1962. Looked in his file and saw that when he died, he had assets to the princely sum of 150 rand in a bank account, and that had been disposed of, passed on to his heirs, and the file had been closed. So we went back to the master and we said, well, now we found this file, now would you please appoint an executor? So he said, fine, I can do that. In the meantime, all of that legislation dealing with black people, apartheid legislation, had all been repealed, and it was a real dog's breakfast as to exactly who had responsibility for what. But the master said, it's fine, I'm prepared to open this file. So we appointed an executor. I then called a meeting of all of our team, and I said, right, we've now crossed the first hurdle, we've appointed an executor, we're now in a position to institute these proceedings. I'd in the meantime spoken to solicitors in London, very competent copyright solicitors. They were on board. Everything was all ready. We just had to push the button for liftoff. Along came the clients for this consultation. And Gallo said to me, we're not going on with this anymore. We're bailing out. Sorry, we've gone to all this trouble. We'll cover your costs up until this moment, but we're not prepared to take this case any further. We've had a change of mind, and it's over. Goodbye, we're out of here. So, I was placed in a situation where we were all dressed up and ready to go, but now suddenly the benefactor had decided to pull out of the adventure. So I spoke to Rio Malang and the attorney, Hanra Friedrich, and I said, well, look, we're not prepared to just stop here. I mean, we've invested too much time, effort, and emotional energy in this matter. We'll move forward with this case. We don't have anybody to fund it at this point, but we'll move forward with it. What we will do is we will see if we can find someone else to fund it, Anglo-American or Rembrandt or someone like this. We'd sort of go cap in hand and see if we could find someone who's prepared to fund this litigation, because we thought it was a very worthy cause. And then we thought, well, do we now go with a speculative case and go and see, say, for instance, Anglo-American and say, look, we want to bring this case and this is what it's all about, and will you be willing to fund us? That was the one option. The other option was to go ahead and launch the case without any funding or backing, and then go to possible financiers and say, well, here it is, it's not something speculative, it is actually a pending court case. And we decided on that approach, which fortunately it worked, but it had a lot of potential dangers attached to it. And but then we thought, now this side of this grandiose scheme of suing Walt Disney in London really can't fly anymore, because I mean, it's one thing to go and instruct expensive lawyers in London to bring litigation when you have a financial backer, but when you've got nobody funding the case, it's not such a good idea. So we'll rather shift the theatre of action back to South Africa, where at least we can get people to act pro amico or on a contingency basis and this sort of thing. So I approached advocates who were prepared to act on a contingency basis, and I myself was prepared to act without being paid in the short term. And so we launched the case. But now, well, we prepared to launch the case, but now there was another problem, and that is that Walt Disney, Disney Enterprises, was an American company. It didn't have any business in South Africa. Now, you can't sue a foreign company in South Africa unless it has some property here. And if it doesn't have a physical presence, what you can do is you can ask the court to attach property to found jurisdiction against that company. So we thought, now what property does Disney have in South Africa? And then it occurred to us that they've got something like 250 registered trademarks, which are items of property which are capable of being attached. So what we'll do is we'll attach Disney's trademarks in order to found jurisdiction and then bring the case. Now that's the route you want to follow. You have to go and persuade the court that you've got a prima facie case on the merits, and that you want to bring the case and that you need to attach the property. So we made out our whole case, prepared our particulars of claim, and prepared all our papers which we would need for the court case, and then we brought an application to court to attach the trademarks, which is an application where you file affidavits. And it's brought ex parte, which means that you don't give any notice to the other side. You just go to court and say, well, here's what I want you to do, will you please do it? And the court, if it agrees, thinks you have a prima facie case, the court says fine and grants the order. So we got an order attaching all Walt Disney's trademarks without Walt Disney knowing anything about it. And we also asked the court to approve a form of issuing papers in America, because that's what you have to do if you're suing a foreign company. So, armed with all of this material, we instructed attorneys in Los Angeles to go and serve these papers on Walt Disney, telling them that they were infringing the copyright in Mbubi by using The Lion Sleeps Tonight in the movie and the stage show The Lion King. The movie had been shown in South Africa at that stage already, so the infringing act had been committed in South Africa. But of course, Disney had not themselves released the movie here. They had used their South African agents for New Metro. So we decided we'd have to sue New Metro as well, because the argument was that Disney was a contributory infringer. They were aiding and abetting someone else in infringing. So you have to sue the person who's actually infringing as well. So we joined New Metro in these proceedings. And away we went. Well, Disney's reaction was unbelievable. They reacted like a slaughtered cat. And they threw everything, including the kitchen sink, at us for taking this action against them. They immediately brought an urgent application to court to set aside the attachment. Because if they could have succeeded in setting aside the attachment, then we wouldn't have been able to proceed with the case because our court wouldn't have jurisdiction. So it became a dilemma. When you bring an ex parte application, are under a duty to make a full disclosure of all the relevant facts to the court, because the court doesn't hear the other party. So there is an onus on the person who's asking for the ex parte order to disclose all the facts. And you never told the court about the 1980 assignment which Regina and the three children entered into with the American company, which was true, we hadn't. And then finally they said, we didn't aid and abet New Metro in releasing this film in South Africa. We played an entirely passive role. We said to them, here's the film, we can release it if you want to. We actually played no part in this. We didn't contribute to the infringement. But the license agreement which they entered into with New Metro didn't bear that out, because there was all sorts of obligations placed on them. They had to do a certain amount of advertising, they had to reach certain sales levels and all sorts of things. So we were able to overcome that problem. We were also able to overcome the problem about the appointment of the executor. The one that gave us the most problem was the one about not disclosing the assignment. Now, the 1980 assignment, the second one. Our attitude was that the family had never come into the picture. The copyright had reverted to the executor. No stage did it pass into the hands of the family. So what the family did or didn't do was actually irrelevant to the rights of the executor, and the court upheld that argument. So at the end of the day, the court said, held in our favor and dismissed the application to set aside the attachment, which was obviously great news to us. I was living on tenterhooks at that stage. Anyway, so we were now dressed up and ready to go. We could continue with the action which we had already launched. We'd served the papers on Disney. But I kind of thought to myself, look, what we're doing here is we're asking the court to grant an interdict stopping the trading in full, plus payment of damages, lost royalties, for South Africa. That's all we could ask the South African court to do. Now, I mean, the damages which were suffered in South Africa would be peanuts relative to the overall scheme of things, the international exploitation of this song. So it would be something of a pyrrhic victory to just get this order from the South African court. It would have been of value, because the court would have found that our cause of action now, that we in fact were the owners of the copyright. So I thought that if we've got to make this thing bigger, we've got to do something else. And so what we decided to do was to launch a propaganda war. We went to the media and we said to the media, look, here are these poor black people living in Soweto. They're being denied the just profits from the exploitation, billions of dollars which have been earned as a result of the use of the song. Big bad Disney, fat cat American company, is not prepared to honor this obligation to pay royalties to the family. And this media picked up this story like you can't believe. And it spread around the world, and it was on CNN, and British BBC television, the London Times ran with the story, the Los Angeles Times ran with the story, I did radio and television interviews, and all over the place we were getting this message over that Disney has this wholesome family goody-goody image are doing this to a poor black family in South Africa. That didn't get out of Disney either. And then ironically, what the media also picked up on, perhaps even to a greater extent in the copyright infringement claim, was the fact that we had attached Disney's trademarks. This to them was an amazing thing. They'd never heard of anything like that. And they made a big issue of how Disney's trademarks were now in bondage, as it were, in South Africa. And the cartoons appeared in newspapers. I remember one cartoon which showed the Disneyland castle. The Disneyland has this castle which has turrets. And in this cartoon, Mickey Mouse was behind bars in the turret in the castle. And the caption was something to the effect that Mickey Mouse was being held hostage. So the media had an absolute war in running this particular story. And it hurt Disney. The fact that their image was being tarnished because they were being cast in this role was not something that they were happy about. So the case then moved on, and we got to the stage where, in all actual proceedings, you have what is called a pretrial conference, where the parties meet the lawyers in order to see whether there's ways of shortening procedures and so forth to not use up more court's time than necessary. And at the pretrial conference, not unexpectedly, Disney came forward waving the white flag, saying, listen, you know, isn't there some way we can settle this case? Which was music to our ears, because what we had managed to achieve by way of funding after we launched the case was we'd gone to the Department of Arts and Culture, and we'd said to the Department of Arts and Culture, listen, we've got this case going. It's demonstrating to the world out there that The Lion Sleeps Tonight is actually a South African song, and that it was written by Solomon Linda, a black South African, which is not acknowledged anywhere in the world. And we think that there is a lot of credit to be gained for South Africa by establishing in the international marketplace that The Lion Sleeps Tonight is actually a South African song. Apart from the benefit that would be gained for the family. And the Department of Arts and Culture bought this argument, and they agreed to fund the litigation. So the latter part of the litigation was actually funded by you, the taxpayer, via the Department of Arts and Culture. But I could see that the novelty was starting to wear off on them, and that there wasn't going to be an endless supply of money to keep this litigation going. And so there was every merit from our point of view in settling the case as well. So we spoke settlement, and in fact we reached a settlement. And our objectives in the settlement was firstly to get acknowledgement that it was a South African song. Secondly, to get acknowledgement that Solomon Linda was effectively one of the co-composers of The Lion Sleeps Tonight. And then thirdly, get income, which is what the South thing was all about in the first place, to flow to the family. So those were our objectives in going into the settlement. As far as Disney was concerned, they just wanted to make this thing go away because it was just causing them untold unhappiness and bad publicity and all sorts of things. And what also emerged is that, in fact, Disney had been quite blameless in all of this. So they were, in fact, sort of a bit of a scapegoat. Because, very correctly, when they wanted to incorporate the song in the stage show, they had gone to the copyright owner of The Lion Sleeps Tonight, which was a company called Abilene. And they had said to Abilene, look, we want a license to use this song in the movie and in the stage show. And Abilene had granted them a license and had given them a warranty that it held the rights to the song, as well as an indemnity to cover them from all damages and costs which they might incur if it should turn out that they don't hold the rights. Of course, nobody contemplated that out of the woodwork would jump Solomon Lindell's executor with his plan. And so from their point of view, if there was money to be paid, it wasn't their money, it was Abilene's money. So why not agree to pay money, for instance, and let Abilene carry the can for the money that had to be paid. So we entered into a settlement with Disney. An agreement was signed, and Abilene was brought into the agreement, which is quite strange, because a settlement agreement in a court case actually involved a party which was never not a party to the court case. But anyway, that was the quirk. And we then issued a press statement. Disney wasn't prepared to acknowledge any wrongdoing, which is quite common in this sort of situation. And so we formulated a carefully worded press statement which took care of everybody's interest. And the salient part read, "It is confirmed that the Lion Sleeps Tonight was derived from Mubi, and that Solomon Lindell was therefore co-author of the musical work, The Lion Sleeps Tonight." So that met our objective of the South African heritage of the song, as well as Solomon Lindell's role. "Solomon Lindell's heirs will now receive appropriate compensation for past and future uses of The Lion Sleeps Tonight, to be paid to and administered by a trust constituted by the executor, of which the heirs are the sole beneficiaries. The executor and heirs express their gratitude for financial support from the South African Department of Arts and Culture in conducting this litigation. Speaking on behalf of the Lion Sleeps Tonight, authors George David Weiss and Luigi Creatori wrote in inverted commas, The Lion Sleeps Tonight, express their delight in seeing this litigation resolved to everyone's satisfaction and believe that with this issue behind them, the public dissemination of The Lion Sleeps Tonight, including a movie, will only be enhanced." So it was a win-win situation for all, in particular for the heirs. We were careful to put in there that a trust had to be established, because once again we had to avoid that the copyright was ever owned by the heirs, because it would go out the window as a result of the 1980 assignment. To this day, the copyright continues to be owned by the trust. But what was the real cherry on top was that we were really, as I said, arguing about royalties in South Africa. That was what the court case was all about. On our wish list was to try and maneuver Disney into a situation where they would pay us royalties for the whole of the British Empire, because we said to them, look, I mean, they didn't know what financial difficulties we were in. As far as they knew, we had a bottomless pit of money that we could rely on. So we said to them, we will sue you in every country in the British Commonwealth. We will go and sue you in Australia, New Zealand, Canada, India, whatever the place. It'll be exactly the same case, and you're going to run up an enormous amount of costs. It's going to take forever, and your reputation is going to be dragged through the mud. So we kind of thought we would get them to agree to pay royalties for the whole of the British Commonwealth. And to our utter surprise, they said they would pay us royalties for the whole world. So we ended up getting a future flow of royalties arising out of the use of the song anywhere in the world, and that is the position which obtains to this time. A lump sum payment was made for past damages, that was the period 1987 up until 2006 when the settlement came. And don't even ask me the question, because I'm honored bound or bound by contract not to tell you what the amount of the settlement was. Disney were astute to put a term in the contract that the contents of the detail of the contract, in particular the monies paid, was confidential. And if that confidentiality was breached, the agreement would be cancelled. So you're never going to hear what the amount was. Anyway, so it actually had a very successful outcome. So that's the aftermath of the litigation. The lion now sleeps in South Africa, in Africa. And there's one pretty happy family. That's the three daughters with Henry Friedrich, who was the lawyer who assisted them. But now returning to my theme, copyright provides means for underprivileged to earn income. Here you had a person who started life as a herdsman in Zululand. He happened to compose what turned out to be a very attractive piece of music which conquered the world. No musical training whatsoever, no academic qualifications or any sort of training in writing music, and yet he was able to compose this song and copyright, after quite a bit of PT, admittedly, enabled his family to get, at the end of the day, their just desserts as a result of the quality of the song, the commercial value of the song. Now you might say, well, that's all well and good. I mean, you have Gallo financing the case, and then you had the Department of Arts and Culture, and every herdsman in Zululand is not going to be able to rely on those sort of facilities. And that is true. But those obstacles don't come from copyright. Those obstacles come from our system of litigation. It's this general system of litigation which makes runs up costs to the extent that they do. You can't lay that blame at the door of the Copyright Act. The Copyright Act gives you the right, and you then are relying on the country's legislation to enforce that right for you. So that's not a copyright problem. So the justice system is an inhibitor. I mean, it is expensive to bring and difficult to bring litigation, but as I said, that's not a copyright problem. There are mitigating factors in this day and age. I mean, you have legal aid clinics, you have legal aid systems, you have lawyers who can act on a contingency basis, you have legal aid clinics like at Stellenbosch University that will offer advice to people. Our chair has a counseling service in intellectual property matters. We will give an audience to anybody who comes to us with an intellectual property problem. And we will tell them whether we think they have a right or not. And we will point them in the right direction if we think that they have a case. We won't act for them, but we will assist them in getting started down the road. So there are these opportunities which Solomon Linda certainly never had in 1962. So the bottom line is, and I come back to where I started, copyright can play a role in society. It can assist the attainment of social justice. Thank you for your attention.